good to go here. Great picture.
All right. Hi, everyone. I wanted to show you at the start of the live stream here, these massive sunflowers. They are just going crazy. Just have taken off in the past few weeks with all the warm weather we've been having. Okay, I'm 5'8", and they are probably about 12 feet tall, if not taller. They're absolutely beautiful, and they provide just so much happiness here. The bees are buzzing around them. The birds kind of peck at the seeds and that kind of thing. I can see them from my kitchen window. I hope you're growing sunflowers in your garden. They're such an easy-to-grow flower and just scream summer. So I'll come over here and get a little closer to do the live. Jerry's going to hang out in the background as long as he can handle the heat. Things are heating up here in Southern California. Finally, we had a super cool start to our spring and summer. It was cloudy for most of the month in May and in June. And just in the past few weeks, we've actually gotten some sun. It's heating up though. I know, like it is for a lot of you. This week will be in the 90s. Which I hear is nothing compared to how a lot of you are doing. We're getting into the hundreds down in Texas, in Florida, Colorado, where Nisha is getting into the 90s like we are. So it is just heating up everywhere. And today we're going to talk about what to do in the garden in July, a July gardening guide. July is a very exciting month in the garden. There's so much to do. The harvests are rolling in, and we're going to have you covered with the essential garden to-dos in July, so you can keep up on your garden and really make the most of your harvests and enjoy the summer garden at its best. So welcome. Thank you so much for hanging out with us here. We've got Cliff and Nisha, our moderators, in the chat. And let's see who else is here. Diva Michelle, very hot in Louisiana. Charlene, pretty garden. Thank you so much. P. Treadway, hot down there in Arizona. I think she said 111 down there. That is crazy, crazy heat. 808 Ladybugs and Debbie Wheeler joining us from Hawaii. And lots of other people here. Let's see, Terry from Southern California. And Kaylee is here. P. Treadway says hi to Camera Guy. And End of the Road, Gourd and Flower Farm, hi to Camera Guy. Jen Van Brunt. Critters got the eggplant, which is always a bummer. We are going to talk a little bit about critters today as well. So thanks for hanging out, and let's jump right into our July to-do list. Oh, before I do that, I want to announce a special live stream that we're having on Sunday. Okay, I know it's a very unusual day for us to live stream, but there's a very special event that Smart Pots is a part of in Columbus, Ohio. Some of you might remember, in fact, Smart Pots is here today as well as Eric from Smart Pots. So glad that you all are here. But on Sunday, or this coming weekend, they're going to be at a very really cool event called Cultivate. And it's in Columbus, Ohio. It is a garden industry event. And Jeff, who's the CEO of Smart Pots, is going to be there. He's going to be taking us behind the scenes of this garden industry event. At this event, it's over 8 acres of exhibitor space. And this is when they show all of their new products that are coming out over the next couple of years. New plant varieties, new garden products. So you really get a sneak peek into the garden industry. He's going to be there live. We'll be here in our backyard, but we're going to be live streaming together. He's going to walk us around the exhibition floor and show us all kinds of cool stuff. If you're a garden geek like I am, and I know most of you are, you're not going to want to miss it. So it's Sunday morning at 9 a.m. Pacific time. Mark your calendars. I will be posting the live stream on our channel probably Wednesday or Thursday. So you can just click on the live button on the front page of our channel and you'll have all the information there. Gonna be fun, so you don't want to miss it. So let's jump into our July garden guide here. Lots to do in the garden in July. As I mentioned, this is the month where it's a key month here. A lot of times you're starting your harvest in July. And I know ours are just starting to roll in the past couple of weeks here. A little late this year. I think we're probably about a month or so behind where we normally are due to all of our cold weather, but you wanna make the most of this month. This is what we're working for, since spring all up until now, is to be getting out in our garden, We've been growing. Now we get to harvest and reap the benefits of all of our hard work, and we get to eat all of our delicious produce. So this is the month to really just put your all into the garden and growing what? Thank you so much for the $1.99 super chat. Appreciate that. Appreciate your support. And thanks for spending the time here with me again. Okay. Let's see here. Oh, that's the first thing is enjoy the harvest this month. All right. You know, get out there in your garden if you can early in the morning because it's been so hot out, or in the evening, just make it kind of part of your daily routine. I think that's one of the great things about gardening is it really does help you build some healthy routines into your life to get outdoors, to enjoy the outside. I love being out in the garden in the early morning when it's super cool. Or in the evening, you know, probably not best to go out in the heat in the middle of the day, but get out there in the morning, enjoy the birds, the butterflies, enjoy all the little, just the life that's there early in the morning. Take your cup of coffee out there. Don't forget your harvest basket because you're going to want to be walking around and checking your plants to see what needs to be harvested. Because for lots and lots of vegetables, the more you harvest, the more they're going to produce. If you leave some veggies on the vine too long, it sends a signal to the plant, you know, just to keep producing the seeds in that particular vegetable. Like if your bean seeds get oversized, it just starts producing the bean seeds, or, you know, they get oversized and they're not any good for eating. So get out there and harvest daily. Pick what you need for your daily meals and see if you can get creative with what you're cooking and recipes that you're using. Get your fresh herbs. A lot of things like greens are the sweetest when you pick them in the morning. So get your salads for the day. If you have lots to harvest, you may want to give some away to your neighbors. I know we've already got tons of the round zucchini, which is a really fun variety. It was in the subscription box a couple of months ago. We've got tons already coming on. I've got 3 or 4 plants and we've been giving it away. Tonight we're going to be probably roasting some in the oven or grilling some up, slicing it for a fresh baked pizza. So just get creative. On my Instagram yesterday, I asked for some ideas on how to use the zucchini and the squash and the things I've been harvesting. So talk to your friends, talk to us here in the chat. That's what we're here for, is tons of garden support. But you definitely want to be out harvesting daily, checking your plants. Certain things like zucchini and beans, if you let them go a couple of days, they're going to get way oversized. And just check the maturity date on the back of your seed packets. And of course, it's always give or take a few depending on the weather. But that kind of gives you a general idea of when to harvest certain vegetables. And you can also check on, you know, the size of those particular vegetables is optimal for that particular vegetable, and then try and pick it about that size. I know most vegetables are the best flavor when they're picked smaller. Like for beans, you want to pick them when they're about pencil thickness. For those of you growing the round zucchini from the subscription box, it should be about baseball size. Cucumbers really depends on the variety. I'd say between 4 and 6 inches long. There are some varieties that are much longer, like the Armenian cucumbers from our July box can grow up to 12 inches long. So just look on, you know, the back of the seed packet or on the information that we supply you on the seed packets or in the subscription boxes. And that'll give you a good idea of when to harvest. Because a lot of times people say, I don't know when to harvest my eggplant or my corn or whatever. And we've got so many harvest videos out there too. So I think we might have a harvesting playlist, but if not, just look up the vegetable that you're curious about. And most likely we have a video on it so you know exactly when to harvest. So get out there and enjoy all of your hard work and enjoy eating your fresh vegetables. There's just something so satisfying about getting out there in the garden and then hauling in a harvest basket, whether it be a big harvest or a small harvest, or just what you need to eat for that day. There's something that's just so exciting about it. Not to mention the amazing flavor. I mean, can we hear it for homegrown tomatoes? A lot of you are harvesting your tomatoes already. Mine are a little bit behind, but hopefully they're coming along soon. So I want to hear in the chat what you all are harvesting this week and what you've been eating from your garden and any ideas you might have for new things to make from things a lot of us have a lot of, like zucchini, Patricia said she's making a pesto out of her basil, which is absolutely amazing. You can actually freeze little pesto ice cubes and then put them in freezer bags and have them all during the winter time. So take advantage of the abundance that you have and freeze things or can things. And I know Cliff and Sandra can tons and tons of vegetables from their garden, so they have plenty to eat in the winter time, which is so much fun to pull out homegrown vegetables when you can't grow them outside. So let me hear in the chat here, what's going on? What you're harvesting? Tracy Monster, great to see you here. Great to see you live as well. Wonderful to have you on. Thanks for spending the time with us. And Robbie and Gary Gardening Easy are harvesting tons of tomatoes and tons of zucchini. So happy. And by the way, Jerry's in the chat back there. You can see him there at the table, chatting away under our channel name. So he's talking to you about that. Nisha's saying, make some pesto, put on pizza, grilled cheese sandwich. I have a feeling you're talking about basil. You know, a garden fresh grilled cheese is actually one of my favorite things and super easy to make. Great suggestion, Nisha. I think it's absolutely delicious with heirloom tomatoes, even if you've got some peppers that you can kind of grill up or left over from dinner last night, throw some basil on there. So I love the white sharp cheddar cheese. You've got some leftover chicken from dinner, a nice crispy sourdough bread. Oh my gosh, it is amazing. So get out there and enjoy the fruit of your labors. So much fun. Pete Treadray, just potted up my tomato seedlings, so I'll have them ready for fall growing. It's not too early yet to start thinking about fall growing, especially if you're, well, anyone really, here in, well, actually we're going to get into that in our next tips. We'll talk about that in just a moment. Irene Moffitt, great to have you here today. Great to see you. I've been harvesting tomatoes and I've been sharing them. Lorraine has been harvesting cucumbers. And you know, I think, one of the joys of gardening, especially when you're growing a lot, is sharing what you grow. That's one thing that really makes me happy, is to be able to bring over lots of veggies to friends, to neighbors, of course, zucchini to anyone who comes to the door, including the mail carrier who does our daily mail pickups. But it is just a fun thing and really brings joy to share what you enjoy doing. And what I found too is it helps people get excited about possibly growing their own. Some people have never grown a vegetable in their life. And when they taste the flavor of homegrown, you can encourage them to start small with a very simple few vegetables and grow their own veggies themselves. So you're actually helping them learn a new skill and learn how to grow their vegetables, grow their own food, which is a very important skill to know these days. Okay, Sharon has lots of tomatoes, but not ripe yet. Okay, I'm there right with you. Mine are coming on. Some of my cherry tomatoes are ripe, and my large ones, I'm very impatiently checking them every day because they're very, very, very slow this year. So I hear you on that. Dawn Star, my trilogy mixed beans are looking awesome. And the trilogy mixed beans were in, I think, 2 subscription boxes ago in our Power Producer box. I think that was the May box. And there was 3 different seed packets or bean seeds in the trilogy bean mix. So I'm loving those too, Dawn. We've been harvesting tons of beans. In fact, I think I'm going to have to freeze some. I've got a whole pile in the refrigerator that I picked yesterday. So we'll definitely be freezing that. And by the way, speaking of the subscription boxes, the July box is now out and selling like crazy. And you gotta get yours this month, guys. One thing that people have been really enjoying in each month's box are the free bonuses. And this month, it's a good one. This one is the free bonus in this month's box is the hose link quick connectors. And if you've never used these on your garden, go over and watch my Instagram reel from yesterday. This makes watering a breeze.
And I do want to say, while we're talking about this month's boxes, we have a video to post of a user who has never posted a video before about this. I gave a little hint. She is going to share about what she liked about her subscription box this month. I'll give you one hint: from the Midwest. So stick around, follow me on Instagram. Cali Camera Guy to see that video.
That's right. It'll be on Cali Kim on my Instagram as well. But these are the bomb. Would you say, Jerry? We actually we're working with these yesterday,
yes.
And we've had these for a while in our garden. But if you are struggling with switching between your watering devices, like your sprinkler,
yeah,
like your nozzle, or different watering tools, this makes it super quick to make a connection from your hose to your watering tools. And this is a free bonus in the July box. It's a $15 value.
Huge time saver.
Huge time saver. So the July box is a great box, and it goes right along with what we're going to be talking about next. The theme is late summer garden. Sorry, Jerry.
Okay.
But Jerry's picture is on here too, so as well as Max.
Yep.
So the theme is late summer garden, and that leads right into our next what to do in July. July gardening guide is don't stop planting. You might think you've got everything in your garden that you're going to grow this summer, but you can grow more. And you want to be planting a fresh new wave of veggies so that once your current garden kind of starts dying out and coming to the end of its life, or you have some pests that come in and eat things, you're going to have a fresh new wave of veggies ready to plant. So for this month, you want to plant things like beans, squash, cucumbers, even zinnias, small dwarf tomatoes, things that grow quickly that are gonna give you a fresh new harvest towards the end of the summer and even into the fall.
Okay, quick timeout. I'm here for tech support, et cetera. Oh. So we've got a great picture, we've got great sound. I'm burning up back there.
Oh,
I'm
yeah.
gonna move into the shade.
Definitely.
Okay. See you.
It's hot out here. It feels like it's maybe in the 90s, although I think it's probably only 85, but in the sun, Jerry's like gutting it out over there. So into the shade, Jerry. Do you want some water? I got water here for you if you want.
Thank you.
Okay, so get that late summer garden planted. For those of you that that live in warmer climates like I do, we can grow a lot of the warm weather vegetables. I think we're gonna have a really warm fall this year in SoCal. So I can still grow a lot of the warm weather vegetables probably into November. But now's the time to get your late summer garden planted. And what you wanna look for is easy to grow vegetables, quick growing vegetables that give you a harvest in about 8 to 10 weeks or so. So like I mentioned, the beans, the squash, the cucumbers, even the smaller size melons that might be pushing it just a little bit, except for you southern climate gardeners, and zinnias definitely are vegetables that you can grow and plant all summer long. So a couple of resources we have for you is the Late Summer Garden Seed Collection. It's got 5 or maybe 6 varieties that are I designed especially for late summer planting, and the Grow Your Groceries with Cali Kim July box. So these boxes are all specially curated to generally fit the climate for most gardeners during that time of the year. And we're going to be growing with these all winter long. Little sneak peek for the winter months are going to be revolving around indoor gardening. So don't think that you're done gardening just because the winter's coming up. But the July box has premium seeds along with the hose link quick connectors and a very special surprise this month that has something to do with garden therapy. And those of you that have already received your box know exactly what I'm talking about. So they're selling fast. Grab one for $7 off with the code Late Summer Garden. You're not going to want to miss this month. And I really hope those of you that have already received it are really enjoying it. So thank you so much. Okay. Debbie was wondering how long Jerry was going to last out there in the hot sun. Glad you moved into the shade, Jerry. And Tracy, those boxes are super cute. The artwork was specially designed by my niece, and we put a lot of work into them. I had so much fun creating them, and every month have a lot of fun thinking of new ideas that you all will enjoy to provide you the resources that you need that month to get out in your garden and really make things fun. And if you have kids, it's a great way to get them excited about gardening as well. Okay, let's see what else is going on here in the chat. Let me make sure I covered everything on, I know what I was going to talk about is about fall gardening too. Those of you that are living in maybe cooler temperatures with a shorter or a cooler, like a northern area with shorter growing season, it's actually not too soon to get your fall vegetables started, believe it or not. It feels like we're just getting into summer. But, you know, if you're cooling off come September, you may want to consider starting some of your cool weather vegetables inside right now because it's way too hot for them outside. That way, as soon as September hits, you're going to have some seedlings that you can put into the garden, and then you can be harvesting those vegetables before the cool season hits. And perhaps if the, or a lot of times when those cool weather veggies are nice and established in the garden, they will actually take some light frost. So we've got lots of resources there for you on that. Fall gardening seed collection. We're going to have some great fall items coming up in the next few months. A little hint there. And those are things like broccoli, cauliflower, peas, radishes, Brussels sprouts, things like that. So start thinking about what you might want to be doing for your fall garden. Keep that in the back of your mind. And if the temperature's right, you can get those veggies planted around September time out in the garden, but get them started now if that's you in a northern climate there. Okay, Laura, how are you? Hey, from Long Island, New York. Great to have you here. And hopefully your garden is growing well there and it's not getting too terribly hot and you're doing well. Vivian, I know my tomatoes were getting the rot on the bottom, but when I started making my homemade fertilizer, I didn't see them on my tomatoes. And I'm very glad I don't see any bugs on my plants. So that is great. It's always great to like get through half the summer here without a whole lot of pest and bug issues. We've been pretty fortunate as well, but the heat's coming, and along with the heat comes a lot of other issues. So let's move into our tip number 3 and 4, which kind of go along together, and that is feeding and watering. Now, especially now in July, now's the time to be really diligent with fertilizing your plants and watering your plants. And a lot of it is due to the heat. You definitely want to make sure that you're watering deeply, which is a lot more effective than just sprinkling your garden, you know, very lightly. Get out there, of course, in the morning or in the evening or with your drip irrigation. And if it's hot, you're going to want to bump up your drip schedule just a little bit. My containers now are on irrigation daily. And even the areas that are in full sun in my garden are on a daily drip irrigation schedule as well. So definitely kind of take stock of the temperature in your area and go around and just kind of do a little, you know, check with your finger there and see how your plants are doing as far as the soil goes. If it's dry, you probably do want to bump up your watering schedule. If it's wet and, you know, you've got a good watering schedule there, go ahead and keep that schedule unless the temperature is really sore. But do make sure you're supporting your plants by watering them deeply and by mulching as heavily as you have supplies for. 2 to 3 inches of mulch helps a ton as far as protecting the roots of your plants during the heat. I can't tell you or emphasize how important mulch is. If you've got shredded leaves, that's a great free resource. Straw is also a great mulch to use. You can get a straw bale. I use the shredded straw from Epic Gardening and absolutely love it. It's convenient. It's clean. It's shredded already. So you can just kind of carry it around your garden in a little bag and add it to your plant. So if that's something that's in your budget, I highly recommend that. But definitely protect any bare soil with mulch in your containers and in your raised beds and garden beds. It's super, super helpful in the hot weather. But it is also important to really stay regular with your fertilizing. You know, you're harvesting a lot of your veggies right now. They're taking a lot of the beating from the heat, especially your leafy greens and your herbs. You're harvesting those a lot and you want them to replenish and grow back. So my containers get fertilized about once a week this time of the year. And my raised beds, I say every 2 to 3 weeks. But you want them to continually be regenerating what they're producing. So especially after a heavy pruning or your leafy greens, you can continue to give them a higher nitrogen fertilizer, like the fish fertilizer, like the good dirt plant food, which I've used both for years, and continue to keep them healthy with the Vermistera worm tea or the Vermistera vitality, which really help contribute to the health and happiness of your plants, if you would. It just gives all that good beneficial bacteria, microbes in the soil, and really does make a difference. So the liquid fertilizers are great to give your plants a really quick boost after pruning or fertilizing. But now in the mid-season, it is important to go around and to each of your plants, if you've got compost, put a little handful of compost around your plants and just kind of scratch it into the soil, water it in. Now's a great time, and that's actually called side dressing. We did a little video on that a few weeks ago about how to use compost in your garden. So now's a great time to go ahead and get your compost out of your compost pile. If it's not quite finished on the top, dig down underneath, get the good black gold stuff at the bottom. A lot of times it's finished at the bottom, even though it's still not quite done at the top. And just go around and do that to your plants. And then you can go ahead and water it in with one of your liquid water-soluble fertilizers, or just water it in with your nozzle. Or your watering can, whichever works best for you. So definitely now in July, very essential task is make sure that you're feeding and watering your garden regularly. Okay, let me just make sure I got everything under that. Oh yes, especially some of those vegetables that will bolt. I still actually have some arugula going in my garden, but it is starting to bolt a little bit. But that gets a little bit of extra dose of water because it's not super heat tolerant. And the extra dose of water just kind of, extends the life of the arugula just a little bit. So really do pay attention to some of those vegetables that might tend to bolt in the heat, and that will help extend their life just a little bit. Okay, I think one of the most important things you can do as far as watering is just stay on top of it. Don't let your containers dry out. I made that mistake. You probably saw that video too. And I accidentally turned off my drip irrigation, and all of my containers and my whole garden completely dried out. And it was a ton of work to get them all rehydrated. So once they dry out, it's so much more work than if you're just keeping them hydrated all along. So do check your garden daily. Containers, hanging baskets will definitely need watering daily in the heat, sometimes even twice a day. So just stay up on it if you at all can, and it'll be so much easier. Excuse me. Okay, let's head into the chat here. See what's going on. How's watering going in your garden? Have you found it to be a chore? Have you done anything like drip recently to make it easier? Are you struggling with watering and knowing when to water or how to water? Ask a question in the chat and I'll do my best to answer it. Charlene says, I need to add some compost. Actually, some containers have sunk. Yeah, definitely your containers are going to be settling over the season, especially from when you first planted. So you can add compost. You can even add some fresh potting mix if you want to, and kind of dig it down into your containers. But they definitely need watering and fertilizing a lot more often because everything drains through. And the smart pots, they're fabulous because they provide a lot of extra aeration, which helps the roots grow nice and strong, so you have plenty of fruit produced from your veggies. But that oxygen also, you know, helps the soil dry out just a little bit quicker. It provides excellent drainage, but you do need to really keep up on your watering with your containers, whether it be in smart pots or whether it be in the plastic containers. But the plastic containers really do struggle in the heat. So that's one reason why I love smart pots, is because all the aeration does help keep your veggies a lot cooler on the really hot days. Okay, let's scroll down through the chat, see if anybody's got any questions. Missouri girl, great to have you here today. And thank you so much. She's saying gorgeous garden. Thank you. We're loving how things are just coming to life. And if you saw my Instagram post on Friday, I was just saying how it's amazing what sunshine does. It just kind of explodes everything into life. We've been enjoying the 80 degree temperatures before the hot weather hits. But it's really such a joy to see the green, to see the vegetables coming on. Behind me here, they're looking a little bit wilted right now because of the heat. The cucumbers are just climbing up over the trellis, and we've been harvesting from lemon cucumbers like crazy and just absolutely loving it. The round zucchini is right behind me as well. And I've got some basil and peppers back there just about ready to harvest as well. So now's the time, guys. It's like gardener's heaven at this time of the year, except for the heat. So make sure you get out early in the morning, like I was mentioning. Okay, Marilyn says, I just got these terracotta watering spikes that you put a wine bottle into and place in the pot. Hope they help stay on top of watering as it heats up here. Those are pretty cool. And you're gonna have to let us know how that works. work. So anything to keep your plants hydrated and make your work a lot, you know, less difficult to get out in the garden to water, especially in the heat. So do keep us updated on how that goes. If anyone has installed drip irrigation for the first time this year, I'd love to hear about it. It's not near as difficult as you might think to install. It is such a lifesaver. And I know some people in an apartment or, you know, may not have access to a hose bib to be able to do that. But if you would all do, you could install it in containers, raised beds, in just about anything. You know, we've got tons of videos on that to help you out here. Okay, Jack, hello, how are you? Time to plant some cucumber seeds and beans too, back in the 90s this week. And Jack out in Maryland is just going crazy with his garden. I think he's got maybe 12 raised beds, Jack, and are already pulling quite a few things out of his garden, and looks like you're going for your second round. So very smart, Jack, to get your new wave going here in July. Okay, Debbie, hi. I have a few baby diva cucumbers. Excited to be able to harvest fresh cucumbers soon. I think that's one of the most exciting things about gardening is checking your garden every day and seeing those little baby cucumbers, eggplant, tomatoes, whatever it is, come on, because it just means that what you're doing is working. And it's really exciting to see the fruits of your labor. So Debbie, I've got tons of little baby divas too, and really looking forward to harvesting those as well. I think those cucumbers, the diva cucumber was in, I think, the May box, has, I think, the largest cucumber leaves I've ever seen. It's just an amazing cucumber, and they all look super healthy so far. So Debbie, really glad that you're enjoying your divas already. Okay, Jack's had some crazy weather too, still cleaning up from the storm. The weeds have gone insane and they're ridiculous after the rain. So you guys had a drought for several months there, Jack. So I'm sure you're thankful for the water, but yet it causes other issues on the other side, right? And that kind of leads us into our next, what to do here in July, in our July gardening guide. And that is, actually that's gonna be another tip in just a moment. But the next what to do in July is talking about pests and diseases, because this is when a lot of the pests and diseases hit the garden. You know, things are growing along fine. It's, you know, right now everything's super healthy behind me. I haven't had a lot of bug issues, just a few, definitely some critter issues. But when that heat comes in and when the rain starts, like it is with Jack there, you're going to have some disease issues and some pest issues. I know for us, with the hot, dry weather, the spider mites just come out and start attacking like crazy. For lots of moisture, you may have powdery mildew. You may start getting tomato blight. So just be aware of that. Be aware that this is the month when those things are coming. Manage your expectations on that. Gardening is not perfect. There's challenges out there for all of us. And we've all been dealing with a lot of challenges together, as we've talked about every week here in the chat, whether it's the weather, pests, critters, whatever it is. And we're here to support you all. So for pests, just stay on top of it. Again, when you're out in the garden in the morning, I highly recommend you're just inspecting your garden, not only for harvest, but also for pests and disease. And as soon as you see it, nip it in the bud right away. Take care of it. It's a whole lot easier to control an issue before it gets out of hand. So check underneath the leaves for pests or diseases. And one thing with pests is sometimes if you wash them off with a good spray of water, you can catch them right away. And unless it's a huge infestation, sometimes they won't climb back up on your leaves. So if you see them right away, you might be able to catch them. But there are lots of different products that I've been using this year that are super, super helpful. We're working with Bonai. They're one of our brand partners. And one like all-in-one product that I'm loving is the Neem Max. I've done a couple of videos on that. But it's pretty much an insecticide, pesticide, fungicide. It covers a lot of different bases. So I can't remember if I put a link in the video description, but I definitely will. That's a great one. I know a lot of you are struggling with rabbits and squirrels. We're definitely in that camp as well. And it seems like as soon as your tomatoes start to get ripe, you've got the squirrels in there taking little bites out of them. Or like for me, the rabbits and the squirrels have been eating away at the berries. The Repels All works really well for that. And it's a natural, has natural ingredients like garlic oil and clove. It actually smells pretty good, but the animals don't like it. So if you can really be consistent with your prevention in spraying your plants and, you know, spraying a little perimeter around to protect from the critters, it's going to go a long way towards helping you have more harvests and less for the pests and the critters. So really stay on top of that. I'll put those links down in the video description. We've done a lot of videos on that so far this year. So you can look up the strawberry video that we did last week. I think when we planted watermelon too, we talked about the Nemax and a lot of my reels on Instagram. Every couple of weeks, we're posting a video about some of our favorite pest control products. In the meantime, a great resource to help you figure out how to deal with problems in the garden. And I mention this almost every week, but it is a really good resource. It's over on bonide.com. It's called the Garden Problem Solver. So you can look up animals, pests, diseases, and it gives a little bit of information about that particular problem. Lots of pictures of insects so you can identify what you're dealing with and then some solutions to deal with them. So I highly recommend you go over and check that out. It's been very helpful for me, and especially this year, we've had a lot of bugs earlier in the season as the rain was kind of, you know, headed through our area that I kind of wanted to look up. So definitely check that out. Okay, let's head into the chat here and chat a little bit. Debbie's asking about Nemax, about the pollinators. And what you want to do, Debbie, is, of course, you always test spray. Anything you spray on your garden, always test spray first, one or two leaves. But I always spray in the morning when the pollinators are less active. And neem oil will affect the bugs that chew on the leaves. So avoid the flowers, spray in the morning, and the bugs are not chewing on the leaves. So make sure that you're taking care in how you're applying it. And as long as it's applied properly, it should not be a problem for the pollinators. So great question there. But yeah, always test spray, because if you're spraying like in 90 degree temperatures, number one, you never want to spray in direct sunlight because it can burn your plants. But if you spray down your entire garden or your entire plant, and then for some reason there's an adverse reaction, you're out that plant. But if you do a test spray, wait 24 hours, 48 hours, make sure that everything looks good. Then you can go ahead and spray the entire plant down. But always, always, always do it first thing in the morning or in the evening, not in the bright sunlight and when the pollinators aren't as active. So do take care to make sure you are applying it properly and following the directions on the back. Okay, Jack, great question here about the Diva cucumbers. How big do they get and are they disease resistant? And yes, they are disease resistant. That's one thing I love about them. They are downy mildew resistant, which can be a huge problem with spots on the leaves, black spots on the leaves. Downy mildew can wipe out your cucumber crop in no time. So yeah, they're downy mildew resistant, which I love. And as far as how big they are, I haven't had my first harvest of them yet, but if I recall, they can be about 6 to 8 inches. So again, you kind of have to test things out and see, you know, what size you like the flavor best at and kind of go from there. But they are a super, super prolific crop. I can't tell you how healthy the plants look, how huge they are. In fact, these are Divas right here. And there's just tons of little baby cucumbers all over the place. I have them planted in 3 different areas of the garden, and they are holding up beautifully so far this season. So really, really loving them. Okay, yeah, Mac does want in on the action. He loves to roll around in the grass, and I'm sure he'll be moving back into the shade in a little bit too. Okay, yeah, he wanted to get there right in the camera view, right? Okay, let's see here. Any other questions? And let's see here. Don't see any questions right now in the chat. So let's move on to what to do in the garden for your July gardening guide. Very, very essential is number 6 is thinning supporting, and pinching. And this is the month to do that because things are literally taking off. And if you don't support your plants, they're going to be flopping all over the place, all over your garden. Not near as healthy if you're not providing trellises with them because they just get to be a tangled mess. You can't get airflow into them. And you really do want to make sure that you are installing supports, hopefully when you plant your veggies, but if not, better late than never. I'm laughing at all the comments about Mac. It's funny. You do want to be supporting your plants, thinning out your plants, and just kind of giving your garden a once-over. I went around on Saturday, and I kind of call it my garden once-over. Went around like from top to bottom. I started here in the chill zone, went all around the garden. And what I was looking for is anything that was spotted or diseased, chopped it off, yellowing leaves, spotted leaves. I thinned out this whole area here because this lemon cucumber plant was getting so heavy with cucumbers, it was kind of flopping over. So Jerry came down and helped me held it up while I tied it up. I put the divas, you know, up on the trellis, the ones that were flopping over, and it is amazing how much that perked it up. I even thinned some stuff out, even though that's really hard for me to do. There are some extra plants growing under here that were just kind of cluttering up the airflow of the plant. I took them out because you don't really want your plants competing with each other. I mean, there's only so much you can grow on one trellis here. And I had so many cucumbers. I pulled a couple out that were, I just really didn't need. I know it's tough, but sometimes it's for the betterment of the rest of the garden, and what a difference it makes. I trimmed up my round zucchini here, cut off a lot of the bottom leaves because those are the older leaves that the plant doesn't really need. And it just provides more sunlight penetration so the squash can ripen faster and the garden just looks so much better. So it took me about 5 hours. I think I was out here from about 10:30 to about maybe 3:30 or 4. And when I was almost to the top of the hill, I said, oh, I'm almost to the top. And Jerry goes, was that your goal for today? And I was like, yes, I wanted to give the whole garden a once over. So I would really encourage you to do that once a month or so. But, do try and keep up with just the staking up and trellising as things grow, because sometimes things need a little bit of help grabbing onto those trellises. So it will go a long way. Pull out the weeds, like Jack was mentioning. If you keep your garden nice and neat and tidy and try and keep the weeds pulled, not only will it look more beautiful and you'll be able to sit in it and enjoy it more, but will also really, really help with the pests, the diseases, and just generally with the maintenance of your garden. So if you keep up on it, it's not too big of a job. The other thing I like to do probably about once a week is get my hose out and just kind of spray my plants down. Now, I know we talk about, trying to keep your plants dry. And the reason why I do that, your plant leaves dry. But the reason why I do that is because we get a lot of spider webs kind of going on in the plants and in the trellises. If I leave those webs there, it does tend to bring in a lot of other pests and spiders and spider mites and just things that aren't so good for the garden. So in our area, because we don't get rain, I usually spray on everything about once a week, keeps the garden clean, gets rid of the spider webs, cleans off the trellises. It just kind of makes everything look nice and bright and shiny. And it's kind of fun to just get out here with the hose. And usually I'll do it early in the morning or in the evening. It's kind of a relaxing activity when you don't want to really get out there and get too dirty or too sweaty or anything like that. It's just something kind of fun to do in the evenings or in the early morning. So I would highly encourage you to do that as well. The other thing you want to do is if you're growing runner beans, one of my favorites is the scarlet runner bean from our bean seed collection. What you can do with those is they can just get crazy out of control. You can actually top those off at the top of the trellis. They can grow like 10 to 15 feet tall. And depending on how tall your trellis is, if you top them off, you're going to get a lot more beans growing and producing from the flowers, and it just helps manage the size. You can do that to your tomatoes as well. But just keep the size managed in your garden, especially if you're growing in a container garden where you don't have a lot of space. Thinning and topping off would be something that you would want to do now in June to manage the size of your garden. We still got August ahead of us, which is going to be fun. But anything you do now can help your garden be healthier later in the summer. And it's therapy too, to get out in the garden and just enjoy what you've created. And sometimes we just sit and look around and we say, oh, all these plants, it's just therapy. We've created this beauty around us. So just enjoy it, whether you have a small garden or a large garden. But whatever the case, make sure that you're back here on Mondays, because we have a ton of fun in the chat, just supporting each other. Even if things don't go well, we can give suggestions and help, and you know, talk to gardeners from all different levels, all over the country and all different climates, really all over the world, and just enjoy and learn from each other about gardening. Okay, let me jump back in the chat before we close out the live stream. See if we have any more questions. And don't forget, you guys, Cliff just reminded us again, the special live stream on Sunday, 9 a.m. Pacific time with Smart Pots. They'll be at the Cultivate Show, and we'll be joining forces with them. Jeff will be there and showing us around the garden show, which is going to be a super, super fun experience. I loved seeing all the cool garden gadgets last year and hearing about all the new varieties, not to mention the flowers there are absolutely stunning. So we're really looking forward to hanging out with Jeff on that. It'll be 9 a.m. Pacific time, and it's going to be fun.
Yes, if you have not experienced Jeff walking through one of these shows, he's fabulous. He just rolls smoothly through the whole thing. And also, we're getting first peek
that's right
at new items headed out to the garden industry in the coming year. So it's really, really fun. I want to encourage you to set your reminders for this Sunday.
That's right. And it's actually a show that it's not open to the public. It's right. Only open to industry professionals. So it's pretty special for us normal backyard gardeners to be able to get a sneak peek inside that show.
Oh, okay. So Jeff is an industry professional.
Yes. Ah, Smart Pots. All right. So, Jeff, thanks for letting us in on that. Okay, guys, let's close it out for today. Thank you so much. Make sure you come back on Sunday. And again, on Monday, we'll be here at noon Pacific time and a few videos in between. Oh, by the way, tomorrow we are going to be filming some information about a late summer garden. So if that's on your agenda to plant, I highly recommend it. Make sure you stay tuned to a video that we'll have coming out tomorrow. And we've got all the resources here to help support your gardening habit, which is a great one to have. All right, guys, have a great week, and we'll see you soon. Bye-bye.